It's not ADA.
Is this on this field with this moment here?
But it's really over in that line. But the green, in this kind of music, the harp support plays with the string bass and the cellos. So we have to bring it over here so that I can lift the string bass and the cellos. But the cover, if you put the cover on it and you open the cover, it goes this way, which projects all the sound that way. So we had to take the cover off.
So it's beautiful.
Thank you. they got all sorts of young.
Cellos, they got a harpsichord running tonight.
Yeah, and I saw a guy that looked like a violin.
String. You know how this goes.
Thank you.
Where are you going?
Great.
Good. Get your home?
No.
Oh,
great. It's a good time.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for coming to our concert. We have a really good season coming up. I hope you'll look at the back of your leaflets and in the back table there and in the narthex are a list of the concerts with more detail. I hope you can come to a lot of them. I want to thank Ming Gao, our concert master, who is the associate principal concert master of the Naples Philharmonic, and all the Philharmonic people and strings here. Beautiful ensemble we have today. And my friend and colleague Jonathan Berner at the harpsichord, who is the organist and director of music at Grace Lutheran Church here in Naples. And I know we have some people from Grace Lutheran here. We have people from First Presbyterian in Bonita Springs and from the Christian Science Church downtown. And so it's nice to have, and we have members of the American Guild of Organists here too. So welcome to the guests and welcome to the residents and old friends and new friends. Handel wrote six organ concertos. He was a virtuoso organist himself. These are the first organ concertos ever composed. He's the first person to put the organ and with a small orchestra. The organs in England were rather small at that time and didn't have pedals and weren't bombastic like the German ones. Handel often wrote these for intermission music at his great oratorios, like Messiah. You do one of these in the intermission. Now, this particular one coming up was written for the intermission of another oratorio, but he wrote called Israel in Egypt. Some of you have probably heard of that. It's not nearly so famous as Messiah, of course. And it has a cuckoo and a nightingale sounds. It's called it's nicknamed the cuckoo and the nightingale. Handel himself would often be at the organ, surrounded by the orchestra. And these pieces were very freely performed. Lots of improvisation, embellishments. In this one coming up, there's a movement. He put organo ad libitum, just organ ad lib, in the middle of this. And he would often improvise a fugue or a slow movement with beautiful harmonies. Some people just leave that out in modern performances. Some people improvise something in the style of Handel. Well, for today, I've chosen to play a movement from another work by Handel, which I hope you'll recognize, and that's the organo ad libitum. He was a virtuoso organist, and people said there are not words to express how Handel played the organ. So the second movement has the cuckoo and nightingale sounds. So when I was in San Francisco, I knew a really fine high school orchestra conductor named Jack Bethards, and he gave me this cuckoo. So I will be using that briefly in the second movement. So I hope you enjoy the cuckoo and the nightingale. Thank you. This is one of the finest organs I've ever played, and I've been playing the organ my whole life, and it's really extraordinary. Organists and their teachers always say the most important stop on the organ is the room in which it sounds, and that's a big part of the way it sounds, the way it does. Mozart was also a wonderful organist. He didn't write a lot of organ music because he was too busy writing other kinds of music as commissions because he had financial problems for much of his life. But he did write 17 little church sonatas, little one-movement things for the church in Vienna. And these are very short pieces because the Archbishop of Vienna, Austria at that time insisted that the mass be no longer than 45 minutes. So there wasn't a lot of music. The sermons, I think, were very short, and the music wasn't very extended. But they're delightful pieces. They're called church sonatas, sonata da chiesa, or epistle sonatas, because they always went in the mass. There's two readings, one from the epistle and one from the gospels. And between those two readings is music. And this is what these were written for. When Mozart, at the time of his death, he had been seeking to get the appointment to be organist of the St. Stephen's Cathedral in Vienna. But had he gotten that post and had he lived, we would surely have had organ music by Mozart to rival that of the great Johann Sebastian Bach. But he died before he was able to be organist of a cathedral. So anyway, these are some of the delightful pieces. Now, the last one, the third one we're going to play is one of the first ones he wrote. There's almost no solo organ at all in it. But the last one that we play is one of the last ones he wrote years later, and it's almost like a mini concerto in one movement. And there's a place for a cadenza. Some of you know what a cadenza is. It's from the Italian word for cadence, but it means a place where the orchestra stops and the soloist, the organist or the pianist or the violinist or the cellist, gets to play whatever they like to play. Now, some people improvise on themes from that particular movement. Some people play cadenzas written by other people, so contemporaneous with Mozart. I've decided instead to choose some of my favorite Mozart themes and make a little pastiche at the cadenza. This comes at the very end of the fourth one. And then the orchestra plays a few more seconds, and that's it. So I hope you enjoy these epistle sonatas by Mozart.